All right. Welcome, everybody. Thanks for joining us. We're going to be playing through a homebrewed campaign of war stories. This is Firelock Games' new World War II tabletop role-playing game. We have a digital tabletop here. As you can see, we're playing over Zoom. We've got three fantastic players with us tonight. I'm going to be your game master, Brian. And we're going to go around real quick. If you guys can just tell us who you actually are, a little bit about your background, and then if you can describe your character's physical and just some qualities for us real quick. So let's go ahead and start off with, as I see you on the top left from my screen, Julio.
My name is Julio. I've been playing TTRPGs since I was in sixth grade, probably. I am playing Private Seamus Boomer Burke, a combat engineer. I'm very excited to play first session.
And what's Seamus look like?
Seamus is a little under 6 feet tall. Red hair. He's got a big scar on the left side of his face. He's not a big guy. Not built. Just your standard wiry 18-year-old kid ready to shoot some Nazis.
There we go. So you have any like personality quirks or things that guys in the unit would know him for?
He's very eager to blow things up. That's his life's goal.
Hence
that's
the
all he cares about. Yep.
Awesome. Thank you, sir. I'm going to my bottom left now, Bobby.
I am Bobby. Forever DM for about 17 years, but I'm happy to be playing again. My character I'm playing is Private Leroy Parker. His friends actually call him Brian. There's a story behind how he got that nickname, but that's for a different time. He's kind of a toned, about 19-year-old, looks like a farm boy, blue eyes, very, very, very blonde hair, but you can't really see it because of how much it's been shaved down. Has a tendency to smoke, even though you can tell that most of the time, sometimes he smokes for real, but sometimes he's just puffing on the cigarette. But he is known for not wanting to be here, but he's here. But he is a good kid from Alabama.
Awesome. Thank you, sir. And last but never the least, Winton.
Hey, my name is Winton. Really new to the tabletop RPG world. This is actually my second campaign ever, so really happy to jump in here and really learn some things. My character is Private Wesley Webb. Wesley Webb is a young, ambitious kid from the deep roots of East Texas. You know, he grew up playing football, leader of his football team. And he really wants to take that ambition and that drive on towards his career in the Army. He's built about 5'11", pretty stocky, and he's not afraid to puff his chest out when he needs to.
There we go. With this visual painted, let's set the scene for where all of this is going to be taking place. These three ambitious young troopers will be starting their share of the war, World War II, in Tunisia, North Africa. It is the excruciatingly hot summer months of July, specifically. We'll find ourselves on July 4th in the year 1943. Now, the United States was attacked by Japan on December 7th, 1941, a day which will live in infamy. But that day has already been a year and a half back. You've been training. When you joined the Army, you were put into the 82nd Airborne Division. The 82nd holds a strong lineage. This is the division of one of World War I's most famous Americans, Sergeant York. You have a strong legacy of heroism and courage under fire behind you. When you've joined, you were the first division to be made an airborne division. Every single one of you had volunteered to become a paratrooper. Nobody was going to force that on you to jump out of a perfectly good airplane and dangle over the enemy, exposed to every single gun they've got, until you fall as fast as a rock and smash into planet Earth, ready to go kick in teeth. You volunteered for it. And it is that kind of tough grit and determination that marks every single person in your entire division. More specifically, though, within the 82nd Airborne, you are in the 505th Parachute Infantry Regiment under the command of Colonel Maurice Gavin. Within the 505th, you're in 1st Battalion, led by Lieutenant Colonel Gorm, in Baker Company, 1st Platoon, 2nd Squad. Now, 2nd Squad is led by 1st Lieutenant Lee and 2nd Lieutenant Stafford, and your platoon sergeant is Staff Sergeant Weston. In 2nd Squad, your squad leader is Sergeant Ellington, and his backup is Corporal Taylor. Beyond that, there's a smattering of troops from all over the United States. The 82nd actually got its nickname as the All-American Division because it did have troops from every single state in the country, the first division to do so. When your grandparents were fighting in the Civil War, it was based on what state you're from. But now, all of you are all mingled in together. City boys from the Bronx and country boys from Alabama, all mixed in. And it is a fun melting pot as you find yourselves involved with now. That being said, and with the scenario set, North Africa captured by the infantry who've gone before you, yourselves training, going to England by a long, long ship ride, another arduous ship ride down around Spain and into the Mediterranean has seen you docked and training in Tunisia. The past couple months that you've been here has not been comfortable. It's swelteringly hot. This is the middle of summer in Africa, and it is scorching. You've been moved 100 miles or so in a tiny, cramped rail car designed to hold 7 horses, stuffed to hold 50 men. All of you have, nonetheless, made it to your destination here. And in northern Tunisia, wherever that is that you are, you have already gone on several jumps, the most recent of which being catastrophically poorly planned, in so much that 30% of the entire division was injured on the landing, with broken bones, sprained ankles, and a significant setback. Not the most encouraging preparatory training. All the same, that is now several weeks in the past. Those with broken bones have been replaced, and the newer, fresh folks that have been training are finally filling in their ranks. But right now, all of you find yourselves enjoying that beautiful, wonderful summer day on the lovely beaches of Tunisia. It's going to be you, Leroy, Private Parker. You find yourself wrongly impacted. A tremendous blow smashing into your chest, sending you skidding through the sand as you kind of come to a stop. Your hand implants into the sand, the water splashing up past it. You hear, through the ringing of your ears from that impact, Private Burke calling your name from further across on the beach, shouting for you to get up. As you look up, it's just in time as you see a projectile incoming towards you at a fast, fast speed. Let me go ahead and have you make a nimble check for me. Agility nimble. Muted.
Give me one strike on the mute bar. am I considered prone at this point?
Yes.
I have 2 sixes.
That'll be 2 successes. Not only do you quickly burst up to your feet, but you catch the football that is being thrown by Private Webb across the beach and make that interception. Private Webb, you had a great pass, but you just got picked off. You see Private Parker beginning to run your direction. What are you going to do?
Going in for the tackle.
All right, hard, go ahead and make me a hard tackle. Make a strength calisthenics for me.
Okay. 3d6s.
Yeah, so whatever your strength number is, that many dice, plus whatever your calisthenics is, which may be zero. You're rolling all of that number of d6s, hoping for a six.
I got 1 6.
All right, it's not great, but it's a tackle. Private Parker, you've just got impacted and rocked. Yet again, Private Webb comes flying from the side of you, sending you down to the ground.
Can I see if I have any teammates nearby that I can lob the ball to that are behind me?
Make an intelligence perception for me.
I'm good at that. I got 1 6.
That's one of success. As you look in the chaos, eager to get the ball away before it gets stripped from your hands, what you see is Private Burke, his hands open, gesturing for the pass.
I'll lob it over.
With a quick lateral throw, it doesn't take much, because you're not too crazy far. Private Burke, you see the ball coming your way. Make me an agility nimble check, please.
Two sixes.
Easily, not only do you get it, but you also brush off the tackle that comes your direction. And with a quick little jaunt past, you find the lines marked in the sand, noting that you've scored yourself a touchdown. As the rest of the squad breaks into immediate cheers and shouting, and some of them dejected words of less kind nature.
I'll run that in backwards while I mock everybody behind me.
With a quick little display of dominance, all of you are kind of gathered here on the beach in this setting July 4th sunset. It's going to be Sergeant Ellington who walks over to all the rest of you. Sergeant Ellington is a little bit on the older side, especially compared to you guys, at 28. He's got a couple years on most of you. He's been in and has been one of the pioneering junior enlisted during his time for airborne operations. Sergeant Ellington is a North Carolina boy with a kind of longer brown hair, kind of wavy to the side. Got these little hazel eyes that are a bit smaller than most folks' eyes, but very, very astute. All right. Hey, you got lucky on that one, Burke. You got real lucky. That was good. Hey, Webb, good tackle. Not bad.
Really appreciate that. Thank you.
Yep. All right, you boys get dusted off. We're going to call that a game. That's a mean tackle I took there. I think I'm going to pop the rib. All right.
Getting old on a sergeant.
Yeah, for now. Give it a couple years. We'll see if I still am. Because the Jerrys will have a say about that. Private Parker, you good?
Yeah, for the most part, but Webb just knocked the hell out of me. I had to catch my breath for a second.
Toughen up, trooper. No time for catching your breath out here, nor will there be on the battlefield. Nope, cough on your own time.
Yes, Sergeant.
Good man. All right. You guys have the rest of the night. Remember your local liberty. Do not go into the town. Burke, I do not want to have to go out there and get you again.
Exodus, I wandered off.
Nope. Next time, I'm going to let the MPs get you. Webb?
Sir.
I know the temptations. of perusing the local cuisine are out there. Would you stay away from those hookah bars?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Okay. I could do that.
All right. Well, you boys go wash up, grab you some hot chow. Enjoy this day of freedom and liberty. Ready to go spread some hell.
Yes, Sergeant.
Sir.
Also, sir. I'm just going to remind you real quick as he goes over to a picnic basket that's next to him, kind of squats down and pulls up a bottle out of it, popping the top on it and taking a sip. You're definitely not allowed to have any alcohol, so don't do any of that.
Understood, Sergeant.
Yep.
All right. Can do.
All right, carry on. With that, he kind of moseys on down the beach. Several of your peers are kind of gathered around. The first one to come up to the two, or the three of you, rather, is going to be Private Corsetti and Private Moretti. These two joined out of Brooklyn. Slightly obnoxious, inseparable, joined at the hip. Hey, Baca, what you got there, huh?
Just me, myself, and I'm supposed to have something else.
Yeah. I see the picnic basket. Come on, Webb, spill the beans. What you got?
Hey, my hands are clean. Don't look over here.
Corsetti, a little bit frustrated that his buddy is getting nowhere. Hey, Burke, man, come on. I know we go way back, huh? We go way back. What you got? You guys are holding out on us.
No, but I'm planning on going into town. I don't know about y'all.
I'm going to be honest.
Put my arms around Webb, be like, so what hookah bar are we going to?
Whichever one serves alcohol.
And ladies?
It's definitely the ladies.
Sounds like a plan. What are they going to do? Kick us out?
Wouldn't be the first time.
What about you, Paca, huh? You going out that way too?
I'm going to be honest. Everything that man said about going to town just made me want to go there. Probably shouldn't have told me any of that.
Exactly. You shouldn't have said nothing.
Like he's like he implanted the dot right here.
Yeah, but don't let him catch you. You know you're going to get crucified if they do. Those MPs, they are not nice.
Oh, they enjoy their job a little too much sometimes.
That's completely accurate.
Hey, they got to catch me first, all right?
And if they do catch me, they got to mess with freedom and liberty.
That's the spirit. I don't know if you guys, anybody here pretty good at driving?
I've always wanted to learn. Can't say
Tell
I am.
You ain't never drove before?
Look, man, some liberties just haven't happened for me, okay?
Ain't that the truth? All right, well,
I mean, I drove my pa's truck around every once in a while.
Are we talking about cruising, or are we talking about moving hooch? Because there's different driving.
Nah, we're talking about being real discreet. Real, real discreet, like.
Discreet's not my forte, you know that.
All right, well, if it ain't your forte, I'd say go hit up Private Sanchez. Private Sanchez, word on the street is, he has the leads on a Jeep.
Oh.
A vehicle would make it a lot easier to get out of here.
Whose Jeep is it? Just out of curiosity.
Hey, see, Corsetti kind of leans around already. Hey, some things you don't need to know, all right? Don't ask. Don't want to find out.
No, he's right, right? He's right. Plausible deniability. I learned that word.
Let's drag Sanchez in here. The more people we got, the more people, more directions we can run in when the MPs show up.
That's what I'm talking about. Hey, plausible deniability. Look at you with the 10-gallon word there, Parker.
Believe it or not, I was destined for great things before I ended up here.
I'll believe that when I see it.
It ain't so bad out here. Look at this. Fresh air in Africa. What else can you ask for?
I mean, honestly, I could absolutely go for one of Ma's fresh-baked pizzas, a little bit of the vintage vino, hanging out with the familia. sitting there enjoying a beautiful night out by the Brooklyn Bridge. Now that's tops.
That's a nice baked ziti.
Yeah, there we go. This guy gets it. It's going to be kind of crazy going back to the old country.
Well, I don't think we're there for scenery.
Yeah, I don't think any of you guys is from Italian descent, are you?
Nah.
Not me.
Not us, sir.
Well, it's going to be a homecoming for me and Corsetti, huh? Yeah. You don't even know what part of Italy your family came from. Hey, shut up, okay? Hey, if you're from Italy, you're from all of Italy. It's all the same. That's completely, that's not true at all.
Don't tell that to a Sicilian.
That's what I'm talking about. You can't say they're nothing to Sicilians. The two of them just kind of walk off bickering like an old married couple.
I'll grab a beer.
It's kind of warm, but it is beer. First beer you've had in months.
Just drink it and be like, man, I love panther piss.
The evening progresses and it gets a little bit darker. You guys are back at the barracks with the rest of second squad. All of them kind of in the process of getting their gear ready, making sure their rifles are clean. Some of them are getting dressed in their dress uniforms to go out on the town. What are the three of you up to?
Dressed to the nines.
Shining shoes, crisp up buttons, making sure.
You know that the ladies love a guy in uniform.
Got that nice class A on, okay?
Double checking Private Burke and Private Parker, make sure we're all straight.
I'm gonna just look while he's. Thank you very much, by the way. I hate the mirrors here, but do I see the guy that might be prone to have a vehicle for us tonight? Because we won't get in and out. We need a ride.
Go ahead and make a intelligence perception.
Oh, you keep naming the roles I'm good at. That makes me really happy.
Don't worry, give it time.
I know. Ones don't subtract in this game, right? I'm not crazy. Okay.
Nope, just if you push your luck.
Two successes.
Okay.
As can I looking... bank one of those as a lucky strike?
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. So take a lucky strike. And remember that those do cap out at two. But they're easy enough to get, so don't feel too bad about expending them. You see across the bay here, this long kind of half of a cylinder barracks that you guys are staying in. All of the racks that are aligned on the sides for you to sleep in. Kind of at the far end is Private Sanchez. He's kind of in the process of combing his medium-length black hair and getting his own dress A uniform on.
I'll just kind of look at him, and then I'll look at Boomer. Kind of look back at him.
Just smile and be like, Sanchez, my buddy.
Oh, shit. Burke, what do you want, man?
So, you know, I'm hearing that we can go into town with you and maybe do some exploring.
I don't know where you heard that rumor from, but that's an unfounded rumor.
Really? So you don't mind if we just kind of come with you? We got to keep each other safe, you know.
You and who else?
Got Webb and Parker.
You guys? You're really dumb. You really dumb enough to go along with this guy? Us. Give me one good reason why I'm going to risk getting busted for the three of you.
Because I'm going to blow up that bridge that'll keep your ass covered later.
That helps, but I'm not convinced.
Look, the more the merrier. He can't punish all of us as strongly as one of us.
Kind of mulls that over for a second. Go ahead and make me an empathy persuasion, Private Web.
Yeah. Besides, the more of us there are, the more directions we can run in when the MPs show up.
If you want to, if you're helping him, Burke, you can add one more dice to that.
Okay, get one more dice. No successes.
Okay. I'm sorry, guys. I mean, you make a convincing offer, but I don't think that I want to risk getting busted down right before we're going to go see some action. I'm a private. Like, I can't get busted down anymore.
Exactly. What are they going to do to you anyway?
What are they going to do to us, Sanchez? Kick us out? Come on.
They already took away my spot in the squad. Now I have to go be the stupid messenger for the lieutenant.
The only thing that could be worse is if maybe they make you dig a hole for the next 8 hours, but that'll be over eventually.
It's all temporary, Sanchez. Come on.
How about this? We'll go in if you help us, you know, get there and we get some stuff, whatever it may be. Maybe we, if you don't want to come, we bring you back like a little trinket or something, you know, a little extra.
I've been wanting to find a pretty good little souvenir to send back to my tias. Go ahead and make a persuasion check of your own, Mr. Parker.
Oh, man, I'm so bad at persuasion.
Sorry, Mr. Parker's your dad. That's Private Parker.
Let's see.
And I'll just be like straightening Sanchez's uniform a little bit, you know, just pour it on real thick.
His ribbons are mad crooked. And not that he has more than two, but they're still crooked. Yeah.
Jesus Christ. What are you doing, Sanchez?
I only had 3 dice on that, but I rolled a 6, 5, and 2.
Hey, there you go. All right. All right, fine, Parker. But I've got 5 tias, and I need a souvenir for every single one of them, and they have to be different souvenirs.
That's fine. We can do that. We'll figure that out.
Yeah, we're fine.
Yeah, we'll figure that out. I'll get some. They can get some. Boomer will get some. We'll pull together.
I'm sure there's some grandmas out there with potholders and stuff. It'll be fine.
Fine. He takes one last kind of hasty comb of his hair. Meet me out behind the command post. 5 minutes. Don't be seen. If they spot you, I'm bailing.
You know me. Discretion is my middle name.
Simple enough. Ask no more.
That he quickly exits, dangling the keys and putting them in his pocket as he goes.
We're in luck tonight, boys.
Nothing eye on the town.
Let me get a agility infiltrate check from everybody. See how stealthy you guys can be.
Oof. 1 success.
Okay.
3 successes.
Wow.
Can I bank 1?
Yeah, you can put one of those as a lucky strike. Or if you want, you can lend one of those successes to Private Parker if he needs it.
Yeah, no, I got 1 success. I got 1
okay.
success.
Okay.
I have like 7 dice at that roll, so I was like, well, I only get 1 success.
Nice.
All of you are very, very smooth as you make your way out of this squad bay, which is not an easy thing to do, especially considering that as you look further down, Sergeant Ellington is kind of sitting camping on one end of it, just cleaning his rifle, and Corporal Taylor's on the other side. You guys time it just right so that Sergeant Ellington is... He needs to get a little bit more of the grease that he cleans his rifle with. Kind of stands up to go refill that. The three of you just quickly make your way behind him and out the door. Crossing through the open air of the base on this night that's gotten rapidly cooler from the 95 degrees that it was earlier. It's down to about a brisk 80 already as the sun's starting to go down. Find your way to the Jeep and Private Sanchez, who's sitting there waiting for you guys. Anybody see you?
Nah, we're cool as cucumbers.
All right. Hey, just keep your heads down when we go. Fires up the Jeep and he scuttles off into the town. A fantastic night of drinking and carousing, enjoying the local sights and some Turkish cigarettes, a hookah that's been provided for you, and some of this local imported brandy. nobody can really understand the locals and what they're saying, since you don't speak Tunisian. But it's good. It's real good. Let me get one last check for the night. Actually, we'll do two checks here to see, first off, how good that night went. So let me get a empathy persuasion from all three of you.
Ooh. That's tough. Eesh, one success.
Okay. One success.
There it is.
No successes. Wait, I have a lucky strike. I'm going to use it already.
Yeah, go for it, man.
Does that just give me one more dice?
Two more.
Okay. One success.
There we go.
Yes. Hopefully, Thea likes to drink. I'd like to take one of those bottles with me for one of the souvenirs.
Okay. You swipe a bottle there.
I buy a bottle there.
Sorry, you buy a bottle, but you do not return it. Right. As you guys are sitting in this dance hall now, on this night that's gotten more and more enticing, the handful of the women's auxiliary corps that are here, female mechanics, supplies, nurses, medical staff, are all out on the town as well. And you see a variety of lovely young ladies, roughly akin to your age. The first ask for you, Parker, doesn't go well, as you find a nurse that is not interested in a lonely enlisted, and respectfully rebuffs your affections. But as she walks away, you find yourself making eyes connect with a young ginger mechanic at the far side.
Ginger's better anyway. It's fine.
She kind of blushes as she looks over at two of her friends. One of them very obviously Hispanic or Italian. It's hard to tell. The other one with this brunette hair that's kind of in these big, thick curls. Three of them kind of connecting simultaneously, eyes across the room with the three of you. You've got their attentions.
I'll come up first. Excuse me, ladies. What seems to bring you out on such a lovely evening?
Kind of look over at each other as they blush a little bit. The Hispanic one seems to be the leader of the outfit. She kind of extends her hand out to shake your hand. You know,
I'll kind of settle in on the Hispanic and be like, hey, and I just have my cover under my arm.
Just taking a break from working on all the cars, all the Jeeps, getting everything ready. Just out here enjoying the town.
Oh, since we have mutual interest happening, you know, we had some free time, you know, decided to come out and enjoy the light and enjoy some great company, some wonderful company. I think we may have found that.
You see the ginger, she kind of is next to you, Parker. She's like leaning in and she looks at the 82nd Airborne patch on your shoulder. Oh, Airborne. You guys are paratroopers?
That's right. We jump out of planes like it's going out of style.
Ooh, we're in fine company, ladies.
All Americans.
Smile back and forth at each other. Okay, okay. The brunette kind of, she seems the most hesitant of the three. Yeah, well, I don't mind going on another dance. Why not? It's a slow one. I hope y'all don't step on my toe, because if you do, it's done.
I'm definitely going to stake my claim right now. And just grab the ginger's hand and go onto the dance floor.
Ooh, all right, Mr. Paratrooper.
Don't worry, they teach us how to dance down south, I promise.
Oh, a southern boy. She kind of accompanies you over to the dance floor where the other folks that are dancing here have gone into this kind of slow number, little two-step.
I just grab the mechanic's hand and I go, beautiful.
She kind of smiles. All right. And accompanies you out to the dance floor.
I look back and wink at Webb. Just smile.
I say, and that leaves one. May I?
She kind of lets out a little bit of a sigh, but there's a smile there. You can tell she's reluctant, but she does want to dance. She's takes your hand as she accompanies you out as well. I don't have anything wrong with, you know, dancing like this. It's just I like fast songs. This is a little bit slow for my taste.
Well, if you don't mind, I need to warm my feet up. So let's just we get a couple preliminary songs, and I'll make sure we're good on the fast one.
All right. Make sure we see you got them footworks. We'll see how it goes.
Don't let me surprise you now.
As the three of you engage into the dance of the evening, it's a very pleasant time. The dance goes well. All of you have a very good time. No feet are stepped on. And as it kind of ends, going into the next song, there's a hand that kind of comes heavily down on your shoulder, Private Webb.
Who?
As you turn around, you see the two most hated letters you could ever see on a helmet. MP.
I immediately turn to Brunette and say, well, this has been a lovely time, ma'am. I wish I get to know you better, but I've got a skedaddle. And I start to back up slowly and try to move through the crowd away from the MP.
Do I see these uninvited guests?
Yes, there's two of them.
I'll turn to the mechanic and be like, it was lovely, my dear. What was your name?
I'll tell you next time.
I just kiss her hand and I and put my cover on and kind of dip it and run.
Okay.
Same for me. Once I see him, I'm just going to look at him. We're going to have to finish this another time, but you're cute as a peach. And I'll just boop her on the nose and just take a cough.
As you start running, immediately starting to book it through here, the MPs immediately start giving chase. Let me get a strength calisthenics. Let's do a strength calisthenics from everybody.
One success.
Okay. One success.
Zero.
Ooh. Burke and Parker, you're making it around the corner, but the two MPs that were chasing you guys, they're focused on Webb. They're almost not even making an effort for the two of you and exclusively go after him.
I'll just turn back and yell, hey, Peach Fuzz, over here.
Private Webb. The first one jumps out trying to tackle you into the dirt. He misses and just you're used to playing football. You know what a tackle looks like. You roll it and he just kind of goes face first into the dirt. The second MP, oh, hell no. He whips out his billy club as he's going to run at you and take a swing. He swings out at you, but you kind of instinctively duck out of the way as he loses his footing.
How close am I to this little tussle?
So you're about 3 meters out.
I'll just grab someone's drink and be like, sorry, and just, you know, throw it at one of the MPs. The MP with the billy club.
You got it. Make me a strength calisthenics for this throw.
Sorry, my dice are still in the...
No, you're good.
Oof, 1-1, and... Six, one success.
All right. The drink not only splashes him, but the glass impacts right into his tooth. And there's a tink. As you can see, a little bit of blood, and he's holding something in his hand. And there's the moment of shock that you realize,
I'll give him a kissy face and run.
I have my mouth wide open and just take off.
Okay, with the one in the dirt and the other trying to collect the bits of his tooth that was just knocked out. You guys make your way back to the Jeep. Sanchez is not here, however. He's still inside dancing.
How far are we from the barracks?
It's about a 10-minute drive.
Oh, man. How many entrances are there to this place?
One.
Oh, man. I look at the guys and be like, we hoof it?
Maybe we can wait them out.
Wait them out where?
Got shadows somewhere, bushes.
Okay, I'll work my way to the back of the establishment.
Okay, so leaving the Jeep up front?
Yeah.
Okay. Wait, we're staying here? I'm with you, man. We got run. That's crazy. You just knocked that MP's tooth out.
What about Sanchez?
You got a Jeep to get back.
Sanchez didn't do nothing. Let's go. Let's have it.
All right.
you couldn't pay me to go back into the den.
You get back over to where the Jeep is. That is the plan, right? You guys are taking the Jeep, or are you guys hoofing it?
Oh, man. I think we should hoof it. Well, I don't want to leave Sanchez that high and dry.
Yeah, he already hooked us up getting us out here.
Yeah, no, we're gonna hoof it.
Leave for him. Yeah, we'll just go.
Okay. So as you guys begin what is going to be about a 3-mile run in your dress uniforms, mm-hmm. through the
jungle.
No. This is desert. This is nice open desert.
Oh.
Let me get everybody to make a stamina check for me, please.
Strength. Oh man.
Here we
go. I'm not good at that. Oh, actually, I'm good at that. Okay, cool.
Pretty decent.
One success.
Okay.
Two successes.
No success.
You add the stamina bonus, right? So if I roll a 5, it's then I have a 1 stamina to 6.
No. That's the total.
That's the extra dice.
Yes.
Okay. Then 1 5, success.
Yeah, like 5 strength and then 1 stamina, 6 dice total.
Okay, 1 success.
Okay, and then Private Parker, you had no success.
1 success.
You had 1. Okay, and Private Webb, no success.
No success.
Okay. Burke and Parker, you guys are running good, but Webb is getting kind of left behind you as he's struggling to run in this very uncomfortable dress uniform.
I'll go back for him and be like, look, I'll dodge grenades for you, but I ain't going back to face MPs for you. Hurry up.
They gave me the wrong size shoes. I got blisters all on my feet.
Take them off. Jeez.
You know, yeah, you run better with your shoes off anyway. Just take them all off.
Damage is already done. Fine. All right. Whatever helps. Start barefooting it in my socks.
As the shoes come off and you start hoofing it barefoot, the lights are behind you now. You can see headlights coming your direction towards the base where you guys are staying down this little road.
Are they familiar headlights?
They're Jeep headlights.
I doubt it, Sanchez. Just keep going. Like, we're in it now, boys. Let's go.
I mean, we can veer off the path and just run on the side in the darkness, and we can see a silhouette. Maybe there's just one person. It's probably him.
It's desert. Like, where are you going to hide? I say we split up into 3, and we cut our losses by, you know, we get a better chance. They can only follow one of us.
All right. Webb, you go that way. Boomer, you go that way. I'll go back this way.
Of course, I'm barefoot, so good luck to me.
See you back at base, boys.
See you then. Don't get caught.
As soon as I see them running off, I'm literally just going to drop prone on the ground, using the sand in the ground to hide myself. they're my distractions.
You got it. You start piling the sand up on top of yourself and just kind of covering yourself. Make me an intelligence survival, please. So how are they to know
when we met? I felt my life begin.
Uno success. 1 success.
You cover yourself very well, and as you kind of get low and to the point where it's really only your face that's sticking out of the sand, and even then it's kind of facing away from the road, the Jeep kind of rumbles past you. Don't seem to have spotted you.
Up and go.
You hop back up. Private Webb and Private Burke, you guys have kind of fanned out The Jeep shoots past Parker, and you guys see him get back up to his feet and continue on. As you head back to the base simultaneously, arriving at roughly the same time, you can see the guard that's on duty at the gate kind of flash the bright spotlight in your direction as he shines it on all three of you coming up. Halt! Who goes there?
It's just us. Do I recognize the guard?
Make an intelligence insight for me.
I'm good at intelligence. I tell myself that I'm 1, 2, 3 successes.
Okay. You do recognize him. That is going to be that is actually Sergeant Seifert, the third squad leader.
Good evening, Sergeant.
Kind of like squints down. Private Burke?
Yes, Sergeant.
What the hell are you guys doing out there?
Oh, we was looking for birds because we heard they had all kinds of pretty birds here. And we just lost track of time and we're just coming home. We got tired of watching for birds.
Dumb Irish. Who else is with you?
I got Parker and Webb. They're both interested in birds as well, sir.
What is this, a friggin' bird watching convention? Get in
there.
We
were trying. Thank you, Sergeant. You have a pleasant evening.
Make sure you report in to Sergeant Ellington.
Yes, Sergeant.
As he gestures down below, Private Roberts and Robbins, two of the other guys from 3rd Squad, open the gate and let you guys in. See Robbins just staring at your feet, Webb.
Just tip my cover. Evening, boys.
Don't ask.
Huh? Oh, you should definitely ask. It's hilarious.
I feel like I'm going to not ask on this one. Maybe later.
Never.
As you get back in and find yourselves probably taking a shower to wash off all the sweat from a midnight desert sprint. A beer in your bellies, though, and a dance behind you, something to look forward to. The rest of the evening is relatively uneventful. Not too much else happens as the following day, all of you are restricted to the base. Everyone, the entire division, held up tight. Nobody goes in or out, no communications in or out. And it's going to become kind of rapidly apparent that something big is brewing. And it's not just that I can't adjust volume levels well.
That night I would have, or in the morning, I would have looked for Sanchez to make sure he made it back all right.
He did. He does make it back just fine. And as conversations will reveal, it was actually him in the Jeep that had passed you guys by.
Should have known.
The 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th passed by. It's on the 9th that the entire battalion is called in for a briefing. Sort of in the early morning time. All of you find yourselves with several hundred other fellows. Up on the stage at the front of this very large tent that you guys are gathered in, with the seagulls squawking outside and the waves lapping on the beach not too far by. The men are kind of gathered around tight. There's a little bit of anxiety, a little bit of sense of unease, curiosity, as you're kind of clustered in, the three of you sitting side by side here. On the top of the stage comes out the familiar face of Lieutenant Colonel Arthur Gorm, the battalion commander. Those very immaculately polished silver oak leaves on his shoulder. As he stands in front of all of you, he calls the room, or rather the sergeant major calls the room to attention, and everybody stands up instinctively, gestures you all to sit down. All right. Good morning, 1st Battalion.
Morning, sir.
I said good morning, 1st Battalion. You guys awake yet?
Morning.
Morning, sir.
Morning.
All right.
Wait, let's see, a little hungover.
It's been 4 days. You're good now. Okay. He standing there, and there's a very large kind of poster board behind him. News has finally arrived to us. Boys are in luck. We are slotted for action.
Elbow whoever's next to me and be like, yeah.
Let's go.
Now, get Parker. Come on.
Yay.
I've been in a bunch of boring meetings, a bunch of stuffy generals, and as the luck would have it, we have been recommended by Colonel Maurice Gavin himself, General Patton, to help spearhead the assault. 1st Battalion is going to lead the way for the 505th. Let's show you your destination. As he pulls a sheet over on this large poster board, for the first time getting an idea of where you'll be headed, is a very large map of Sicily, this southern island, very massive island, but an island all the same off the coast of southern Italy. This is our destination, boys. We're gonna punch into Sicily. Mr. Churchill keeps referring to it as the soft underbelly of Europe. What better place to strike? Kind of makes like a knife stabbing gesture. All right, 505th, we will be flying in the nighttime prior to the beach landings of our boys. Our objectives are gonna be to secure, kind of points onto the map on the southwestern coastline. Right here, Ponte Olivo Airfield, points to another one. The Scari Airfield. Those two airfields will be our first objectives. After that, we'll move up to Nishemi. If we take all of that successfully, we will advance, and he kind of points to a dashed line that goes across the map. We will advance to the yellow line. And let me actually see if I can share this screen with you guys so that you can see this map for yourselves. You guys able to see that?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
If you look down there on the bottom, kind of where Patton is, you see the box with a cross on it. So a brief map reading lesson. A box, right? All of these boxes, these rectangles, represent a unit. An X is going to be an infantry unit. If you see the 3 on the top, that means it's a regiment. If you see the 2 X's on the top of some of those boxes, that means division. Division is thousands of dudes. The number to the right is the number of whatever that unit is. So on the bottom with that dashed line, the 505th, and then the 3 lines regiment. It's kind of hard to tell, but on the bottom of that box, there's like a little seagull looking thing. That means airborne.
Airborne.
So you guys are the 505th Parachute Infantry Regiment. You're going to be flying over the 1st Infantry Division, 3rd Infantry Division, and 45th Infantry Division. If you can see the parachute icon, that is your intended drop zone. All right, boys, now, situation on the island is this. We know that the 6th Army of the Axis Powers stationed here under an Italian general named Guzzoni. The Nazis are here as well. From according to our intelligence, they have a division called the Hermann Goering Division. That is most likely who we will run into where we are headed. I know some of you may have been talking to infantry and armor who fought the Italians here in Africa. Tell you that the Italians are a bunch of pushovers. Make no mistake that the Nazis, Italians, not be more different. Like us and the Brits. maybe the French would be a better example. Anyways, our objective, fly in, get down there, secure those airfields before the landing starts so that they do not have air support to attack our boys on the beach. Once we get those secured, we move up to Nyshemi. We take Nyshemi and we hold that road. Do not let them reinforce. We understood on all points therein.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You boys have trained for this well and hard. You have jumped many, many, many jumps. And I think most of you are healed up after that last jump when a bunch of you wanted to not land properly.
I just have like a blank deadpan stare on my face.
All right, at this time, I'm going to open it up for any questions for anyone who doesn't understand. What questions do you boys have?
When do we leave, sir?
Tonight. Once your gear's ready, got everything packed up and ready to go, make your way out to the airfield, sleep on the flight line. Use those parachutes as sleeping bags. Big pillows, pretend you're back home in Mama's kitchen. Or wherever the hell you people sleep, I don't know. Kind of looks around. Some of you, I think, probably the doghouse. Nah, I'm just kidding. What's up? You have a question, Private Webb?
No, sir. Ready to get out there, sir.
Good. Good man. I like that fighting spirit. 82nd Airborne Division. All Americans.
All Americans.
Oh.
Remember the legacy of this unit. I don't need to remind all of you the story of our predecessors who've gone before us, like Sergeant York. Sergeant Alvin York, World War II, single-handedly dealt death and defeat to hundreds of Germans. That is the power of one man in the 82nd, with the iron will and a refusal to be defeated by anyone. That same iron will lives today in all of you. I will be with you, and I will make this jump with you as well. When you land, should you find yourself scattered, find your fellow paratroopers. Work together in what we've affectionately dubbed LGOPs, little groups of paratroopers. Anywhere you find your fellow comrades, link up, cause havoc, create chaos. You see the enemy? Shoot them down, no hesitation, because none will be shown for you. Is that understood, boys?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir.
Very good. With that, I'm going to leave you all here with some words. Kind of pulls out a pamphlet. This is from Colonel Gavin. Each and every one of you. Soldiers of the 505th Parachute Combat Team, tonight you embark upon a mission for which our people and the free people of the world have been waiting for 2 years. You will spearhead the landing of an American force upon the island of Sicily. Every preparation has been made to eliminate the element of chance. You have been given the means to do the job, and you are backed by the largest assemblage of air power in the world's history. Make no mistake, boys. The eyes of the world are upon you. The hopes and prayers of every American go with you. Since it is our first fight at night, you must use the countersign and avoid firing at each other. The bayonet is the night fighter's best weapon. Conserve your water and your ammunition. The term American parachutist has become synonymous with courage of the highest order. Let us carry the fight to the enemy. make American parachutists feared and respected through all his ranks. Attack violently. Destroy him wherever found. I know you will do your job. Good landing, good fight, and good luck. Colonel James M. Gavin. Those are the words I leave you with. Get yourselves kitted up. Get situated. Make your way to the tarmac. Those rifles will be clean so that you will fire successfully and true. I wish you all the best. Godspeed. I will see you when we land.
At this point, we all stand up and salute, probably.
Yep, everybody hops to their feet with a quick salute. He returns it as he makes his way out of the large tent. As all of you are dismissed from here, you kind of slowly exfiltrate. Is there anything anybody is doing prior to the jump here?
I'll grab Parker by the shoulders and be like, we're going to kick some kraut teeth.
I'm going to be honest with you. I have two problems with this. Number one, he never said when we were going to stop doing it. Just go to the yellow line. And then we didn't even stop then. He just said, go to the yellow line. And I mean, are we going to have enough food? I mean,
Don't worry about it. We'll take it from the crowds that we take down.
I suppose, man. If we make it to the ground, you know, I've done the math. There's like a 34% chance we don't even live.
Wait, who's better at math, you or me?
Me?
No. It's going to be me. And my math works out just fine.
I feel like we're about to have a mathinesium right now, but that's for a different time.
I'm looking at my notes in my journal, and some of the notes I've written on my days here so far, and just reminiscing one more time as my custom ritual before my missions.
Okay. As you sit back and reflect on your time, your travel across the entire Atlantic, down through the Mediterranean, here in the hot summer of Tunisia, and with the orders that you've got, your journal is a good reflection point as you think back on your life back home, what you have to look forward to. The rest of the day. Yeah?
I'm sorry, I'm packing and just whistling a jaunty Irish ditty the whole time.
Okay.
Going through my stuff, making sure everything's together, making sure I have as many packs of smokes as I can possibly find with me in different areas, different compartments, just so I don't know how long we're going to be there.
Okay. Make a note, all of you, if you would, for your gear, right? What of that gear is in what bag?
Because
when you jump, everything's got to be packed. You may have multiple bags. You may have a musette bag, the leg bag.
Backpack.
Yeah. So take note of what gear is in what bag. The sound of the ocean as nightfall comes and you've had a couple hours to nap is replaced. A kind of slow whirring sound. As that engine begins firing up. On the C-47, on the flight line up ahead of you. Sergeant Ellington comes by. All right, stand up, let's check gear. Private Burt kind of helps pull you to your feet with your gear, all of the stuff that you're carrying weighs probably close to 100 pounds. Now, between your rifle, your ammo, your equipment, your parachute weighs another 35 pounds. So you're carrying 135 pounds worth of gear on you, and some of you, string beans, don't weigh a whole heck of a lot more than that in the first place. So it's like carrying your body's weight with you. It's pretty uncomfortable, and getting up from the ground is like a turtle trying to stand up. But as you guys are helped up to your feet one at a time, I gestures past you to load up. Private Parker pulls you up to your feet.
Yes, sir.
Gear's all good.
As good as it's gonna get, sir.
All right, load up, buddy. Private Webb.
Sir.
Pulls you up to your feet. Everything good?
Dotted my I's, across my T's, sir.
Good man. You got the little radio?
Right here.
Don't lose that.
Will do.
When we hit the deck, wherever we hit the deck, find me. We're going to make communication with headquarters element. That's our first priority.
Roger.
All right. Let's go, boys. Load up. As you guys kind of file, single file, all of second squad, along with Private Sanchez, being the last and final 18th person, the C-47 is now loaded up from these two little aisles of, like, bench seats in it. And all of you are kind of strapped in. The smell of this aviation gas burning begins kind of filtering into everyone's noses here. And the taxi that progresses is bumpy. It is a rough, prop wash, splattered takeoff as you finally get to the air. And immediately, the breeze that you felt on the ground, which was nice, kept you cool in the summer heat, and the sky is kind of rocketing it from side to side. The plane's individual kind of gristly hum gets replaced by the continuous drone of over 240 airplanes, all these C-47s flying in tandem here. The beach is gone. It's just you and the drone. You can barely hear each other, but you have some moments now in the darkness as you fly up and over the Mediterranean. What are you guys doing on the plane?
I'm just, handing my MESET bag, just checking my blasting caps, my TNT, making sure I got all my good stuff in order. It's kind of making a mental checklist to take my mind off of it.
Is smoking allowed?
Nope, no smoking on the plane.
I'm just jotting down in my journal.
Okay.
I'm doing air drums to some swing jazz song I have in my head. Just hyping myself up.
Bella Fitzgerald was there, she would have been rocking and rolling with you. But as it stands, it's only in your own mind. As the night progresses, let's get a just give me a straight D6 roll. Odds are on the left side, evens you're on the right.
Odds for me.
Even.
Okay.
Odd.
All right. So, Private Burke, you're facing across from Private Webb and Private Parker. Let's have Private Burke make this just a D10 roll for me. Let's see how far into the plane you are. I did tell you there'd be some D10s.
Yep. I got it. It's right here. 6.
You are 6 seats back. So the way that the planes work, right, is that the door is going to be towards the backside. Let me do a math for a quick moment. There's only a couple of people that are going to be jumping before you. Parker, you will be the third person to jump. Sitting across, directly across from you, is going to actually be Private Sanchez. Then after him in the order would be Webb, and then Burke, and then the rest of the squad behind y'all. The little bit of lights that you could see over Tunisia out the small windows vanish into just the black expanse of water as the flight begins pushing past its first hour. The seats are not comfortable. Like, this is maybe plywood on top of steel. You feel every bump. As the first hour pushes into the second, what are you guys doing?
Rocking from cheek to cheek. Kind of squeezing a little bit, you know, using my elbows to prop myself up a little bit. But being fidgety generally.
Okay.
I'm looking for
whoever. Might be AR.
Yeah.
I'm looking for whoever wants to play rock, paper, scissors.
I'll play with you.
Shit, I'll play. Oh, okay.
Sanchez even gets involved with it too, as the rock, paper, scissors games progress. It's a brief moment of levity with the gravitas that you guys are flying right towards battle for the first time in all of your lives. Your parents, your dads may have fought in World War I. May have even fought in some of the small skirmishes. Your older parents or uncles may have fought in the Spanish-American War. You may even heard tell from the oldest old timers around when you were kids about the Civil War growing up. And what that was like to stand in rows and rows of men to just be mowed down. You've heard the horrors of trench warfare and how monotonous the slog was. Mud and death every day, day in, day out, no respite. All those thoughts are in your mind of what kind of warfare you'll face when you get down there. You've heard a lot about the enemy. You never met him. There's a little bit of tension within each of your guts that begins starting to slowly develop. For a second, it almost looks like you can see the stars outside. But the stars are kind of bright and white. And these stars, they're yellow. They don't stick around long. There's no signs of Sicily. You're still out over the open water. The plane starts shaking a little bit more violently, as the revelation that these stars you thought you were seeing are explosions from flak cannons being shot up at your air fleet. Private Webb, roll me a d10, please. Or excuse me, a d6, actually.
Okay.
Sorry.
5.
Okay. And now roll me a d10.
10.
there is a smattering of machine gun fire that rakes into the hull of the plane. These loud impacts punching holes up through the floorboard. Private Webb, the guy two seats down from you, as you're watching these holes shoot up, you watch his head pink mist against the roof as a shot flies between his legs and up through his jaw out the top of his helmet. His body slumps over in the floor. I need everybody to make a guts check, please. Bobby, that was your number two character that was just killed. You did.
I didn't like him anyway.
One success.
Okay.
One success.
One success.
You guys steel yourselves in your resolve as the light on the door turns red. All of you know from your training, red light, stand up, hook up, get ready. Sit there and quickly hook yourselves in. Let me get a tech check from everybody.
Oh, that's my best.
Intelligence tech.
Eight dice.
There we go.
Oops. One, two, four successes.
Wow.
Nice.
Three successes.
Okay.
One success.
All right. Burke and Parker, not only do you guys get yourselves hooked in, you take some of the rattled dudes around you and are able to help hook them up as well, kind of steady them for a little bit. Make sure that their gear is worked. There's one guy who's actually hooked himself on backwards, Burke. You realize that if he jumps like that, that chute's not going to open.
Yeah.
And you very quickly undo it. Parker, the guy in front of you, excuse me, it's actually Sanchez. The way that it's wrapped, he doesn't know it, but it's going across his chest. If he jumps like that, it's going to snap his neck. You're able to fix that for him.
I'll turn the guy that I helped around and I'll be like, look at me. I just kind of like put my forehead against forehead. Let's go get some grouts.
Okay. All right. Yeah.
Slap on his helmet, slap the top of his head, turn him around.
You can see there's fear. There's anxiety. There's excitement. There's this palpable aggression of everybody that is in the same mindset of getting ready for action. The flak gets louder now. Parker, you're the closest to the door. Make a perception check for me.
Two successes.
As you look out the door, the first thing that you notice is that not only are you still not over the ground, you're over the water, but the C-47 next to you takes a flak round straight to the engine. It explodes and just buckles in on itself, going down in a fireball.
I'm just gonna yell out, you guys see this shit? It's going down. Point out the side.
Don't worry about them. Look forward.
Almost more worryingly than that, there's another plane where the paratroopers are already jumping out over the middle of the water in panic to get out of the plane.
Secure my helmet, kind of steady my breathing. I'm just looking forward.
Okay. Let me get the next D6 roll. Who rolled that first D6 for me?
That was me.
That was you. Okay, so can I get this next one from Private Parker, please?
Six, actually.
Okay. The plane is rocked. As it's hit, the entire plane is windy. There's a strong breeze pushing in. As all of you kind of struggling to look behind you. Let me get a perception check from each of you, please.
One success.
Okay.
Seven dice on this one.
There we go.
Two successes.
Okay.
One success.
What all of you will notice is the gaping hole that was the cockpit. And you can see pieces of one of the pilots that's kind of dangled over in the space where his upper half would be. You can see ribs sticking out from what should be attached to a head. Beyond that, you can see the lights of some villages up in the distance, and you feel the plane rocking slowly to the left, no longer guided by any pilots as the cockpit has been blown off.
Is which side of the land towards, our left or our right?
As you're coming at it, it's kind of diagonal, like the right side is closer, the left side is further, but your plane is starting to list a little bit to the left.
So further away from land.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Oh yeah, we gotta jump now.
Yeah, who's operating the light?
Nobody's operating the light anymore. It's the guy who did it.
Yeah,
he's up there by the pilot. Yep.
Yeah. They're like, all right, boys, time to go. Go, 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 go.
Let's get out of here.
One, two, go.
Make a command check for me, Private Burke. Private Webb is helping you. You can add a dice to that.
Thank you, because my empathy is not good. Hey, two successes.
Okay. You convince them after a moment. But there's no light! There's no light!
There's no cockpit! Go!
As the guy in front of Sanchez kind of reluctantly, like, starts to get out, some of the flak fire comes by, and you see it just blow off his leg in the door. Just kind of falls to his butt and bounces out. The guy in front of Sanchez, eyes wide, gets shoved full force by Sanchez, who quickly jumps out after him. Parker, you're up. Make a guts check. This is related to parachuting, so you get to add a dice for that as a paratrooper.
Nice.
And miss one success.
All right. You steal your will as you run to the door, grab your hands on the bulkhead, and throw yourself out. Arms quickly across as you jump out, the line behind you rips out. You feel the jerking motion of the parachute opening up. After you is going to be Private Burke. Make me a guts check. This is related to paratrooping, so you can add a dice.
Zero successes. One. There it is. One.
Okay.
I was going to use my lucky strike.
Yeah. You feel that moment of like, oh, but you steal your will to it. You saw Parker go and you're not about to leave him behind. So you very quickly follow suit behind him. Webb, you're right behind that. Who didn't roll a D6 yet?
I haven't.
Okay. So go ahead and roll me a D6, please, sir.
Four.
Webb, you're the last one on, right?
Right.
Make me a nimble test, please.
Nimble. Okay. One success.
Okay. As the next burst of flak rattles the plane and it kind of starts to veer even sharper to the left, you hold your footing long enough to jump out and go tumbling through the air. Just head over heels. The cord rips, and you find yourself able to activate that chute. Not without peril, however. As worryingly now, the drone of the planes begins fading as their distance from you increases. And you are left now with just the sound of howling winds as you float yourselves downwards, more and more towards the ground. There's no sound around you now, but the gunfire, the flak, the occasional engine of an errant C-47 trying to find its way, and the howling wind. The winds? You guys have jumped before. You know there's an acceptable window for how much wind. It's usually like 5 to 15 miles per hour wind. This wind's closer to 45, and it's blowing you, most of you, almost a 45 degree angle. Fortunately, that direction is pushing you north, over towards the land, and not the water that was below you when you jumped. Let me get a perception check for everybody. Minus one dice, because this is going to be looking through the dark. And none of you have dark vision. Ha ha ha.
I have low light. No. Six dice.
One success.
Okay.
Surprisingly, out of all of my dice, no successes.
No successes out of six dice.
You two are focused solely on the parachuting and trying to maneuver yourselves and face with what you can towards the land more. But Webb, as you've been kind of whipped around and you're still in the process of riding yourself, you see the source of that anti-aircraft fire. All the flak that was shooting up and the machine guns. It was the invasion fleet. That was the American invasion fleet shooting up at you guys. In what is one of, or what will become, one of the biggest friendly fire incidents in the entire war.
Wow.
You continue all floating downwards, and you are not out of the woods yet, my friends. So, let me get everybody to roll doubles for me. So this is 2d6, and this is going to be a one for your tens place, and then one for your ones place. Keep those once you've rolled them. We're going to do these scenes I'm going to go from bottom to top this time. So we'll start with Webb, then Parker, then Burke. So keep your dice rolls and let me know what you got. So we'll start with Webb.
13.
13. As you find yourself getting ever closer towards the ground, it becomes evident that you're headed towards what looks like a waterlogged field. As you come down for your landing, intending to just kind of ragdoll to loosen it, you immediately shloop as you go waist deep into mud. Also, let's see a thing real quick. Roll me a D6, please.
Thought you were about to say, roll me a new character, please.
You landed on the mine.
Six.
You got a six?
Yes.
Okay. Miraculously, despite how rough your departure from the plane was, you didn't lose any gear on the way down. You have all of your stuff with you as you land. It's mudlogged, but you've got it. Also, make me a stamina check, please, from the battering that you took on the jump and the landing.
Does it get an extra dice because it's related to parachuting?
Yeah, actually, yeah. Good point.
Thank you. No successes.
Okay, you will take 1 point of damage to your endurance. And since the DM chooses where your first point of damage goes, this one's going to land on agility. As your legs are going to suffer on that landing. You're not quite as nimble on your feet as you used to be, and you're in a bit of pain. May have a sprained ankle on that, despite landing in mud.
Oh, okay.
So your overall endurance goes down, and bubble in that first tick for weariness.
Okay.
You are now tired. All agility rolls you make will be minus one dice now, until that's treated.
Got it.
Private Parker, you are up next. What'd you get on your doubles?
42.
42. You are falling, and you're relieved that the round that came up towards you didn't hit you, but it did take almost a yard out of your parachute, and you are falling much more quickly than you would have liked. As you fall rather hard, coming in way too fast, go ahead and take 2 points of damage to your endurance, but make me a nimble test. Any successes you have for this will mitigate some of that damage. One success will mitigate 1 point of damage. Muted.
Number two. See, we had a conversation earlier about nimble. I told you nimble's ridiculous.
It's really good.
One success.
Okay, so instead of two damage, you just take one. This one will also go to your agility. Your chute comes down hard. You ragdoll it as best as you can, but man, your knee kind of did a little number that it shouldn't normally do. And just the intensity that your heart has been going through with pumping that adrenaline with the, I'm about to die, I'm about to die, I'm about to die, I'm about to die. That the moment you hit an impact of the landing, you are already out of breath. So you have 1 point of weariness. You can see that nearby is like a small pond that's started drying up a bit, where Private Webb has flopped into. And Private Burke, what did you get on your doubles?
56.
56.
Like, you're dead.
As you come falling downwards, actually, before we get to yours, Private Parker, roll me a d6.
Five.
You lose your leg bag on the jump and everything that was in it.
I didn't need rations. I didn't need gas masks. I didn't need that stuff. Nope.
You're good. Private Burke, as you come falling downwards here, you find yourself with a relatively soft landing. You ace the landing, and it's quiet where you are. It's like strangely quiet.
A little too quiet.
Even the sounds of the gunfire are less than they were. What you will hear, some of the critters, insects, an owl off in the distance, as your chute kind of lands in this tall grass next to you. Slightly more worrying, though, is that in this quiet, you hear a conversation. Two hushed voices talking to one another.
Is it in English?
Make an insight check for me.
Four successes.
Okay. The conversation that you hear is in Italian.
I'm gonna unhook and just kind of drop to the ground and kind of look up around, see if I can see where the other troopers are going towards.
There are parachutes scattered all over the place. It is bedlam how scattered the drops are. You see the fireballs streaking through the sky of C-47s on their way to a fiery doom.
I'm going to work, attempt to stealthily work my way opposite of the conversation.
Okay, so make me a infiltrate check, please.
Has to do with parachuting?
Nope. That's not a catch-all.
One success.
Okay. Kind of getting low to the ground and keeping away from these Italian voices. Kind of go parallel to it. Till a couple moments later, as you find yourself moving through tall grass. Excuse me. There is another parachute that you start coming across. And it has absolutely been shredded by anti-aircraft fire. You can hear some quiet, probably cuss-laden words being quietly muttered by Private Parker.
Parker, is that you?
Yeah, it's me. I Webb's over here, too. I see him.
Shh, there's Italians over there. Get me out of here! Shut up! I'm like done.
I'll kind of crawl over to him and see if I can help get him out of the muddy area that he's in quietly.
Okay.
I'll watch his back.
So let me get a infiltrate check from Private Parker and a perception for Private Burt.
This one's good.
Webb, this would be a calisthenics check for you as you try and muscle your way out of the mud.
Three successes.
Okay.
No successes.
You're stuck in there, man. Remember, too, if you guys have multiple successes, just check the sheets that I gave you, and there are some definite benefits for these. So, like, on your perception check, right? With multiple successes... Where did it go? Multiple successes, obviously you can take a lucky strike for each additional success. You might get a little bit more information than you intended. You can have another character benefit from that. What'd you get, Private Parker?
I got two successes, and I wanted to put one in as a lucky strike.
Okay, you got it. Take that strike. Private Parker kind of crawls over to where you are stuck in the mud, Private Webb. He's able to kind of extend a hand out towards where you are as you realize that you've kind of landed in what was the bank of this little pond that has started drying up. You've just been stuck right in the muddy part. It's not as muddy for Parker because he didn't hit it at full force from the sky.
Do I see that they're having trouble getting him out?
You can see that Parker's stuck. I'm sorry, that Webb is stuck. But that's likely just because of the angle that he fell at. You could probably move into that mud without too much hassle.
I'll go back and grab the shredded parachute. I'll cut off the strings, grab the nylon, just kind of roll it up a little bit and go back over there and be like, put this around you. Put it under your arms.
Okay. That's clever. So you kind of, you're fashioning this, make me a, let's call this one intelligence survival for how well you're able to make this kind of makeshift contraption on the fly.
All right. Five dice. Two successes.
Okay. So as you kind of fashion this rapidly with the straps from the parachute. You throw it out. Webb, you're able to grab onto it. And between it, Parker and Burke, they both pull you out of the mud. Oh, Burke, sorry. Roll me just a D6 real quick. I forgot to ask you for your gear check.
Let's say I was the only one that lost anything so far.
Six.
Okay, miraculously, you have managed to keep all your gear. A six is the only number that doesn't lose stuff.
Okay, I was like, I don't know, it's high or low is good, but this it is
weird. Yep. For this one specifically, you needed a six to keep everything. Every other roll was a loss. As you're sitting there with those, with that high perception check that you got, Private Burke, you can hear the Italian voices are getting a little bit louder. They're getting closer.
Okay, I'll go prone and take my bar out and just kind of, you know, motion everybody to get down.
Okay.
I don't want to shoot on some random civilians.
For sure. Private Webb, what are you doing?
I'm tending to my ankle, trying to massage it out and just be quiet while I muscle out some pain.
Okay. You did take 1 point of endurance damage, right?
Right.
So if you'd like, let's see, you could try to make a medical aid check on yourself to remove that.
Okay, I'd like to try that.
Because you've got all your gear, right? And you do have a med kit in there?
Nope, I haven't an escape and evasion kit, but no med kit.
Should be one of the mandatory items for the jump.
Yeah, it was. Maybe you forgot to put it in there.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, I had that on a different sheet. Yep, okay.
Okay.
Pull that one up, too.
Yeah, because your backpack... Your backpack was 4 slots. Your leg bag was 3 slots. A musette bag is 2 slots.
True.
Yeah. And one of the items in there should be personal first aid kit, which is for you to use. But it is of one use, and it will be expended after this.
And then the Corman kit.
Corman kit has to be used by a medic.
Yep. I'll start just kind of unhooking everything, you know, while I'm on the ground and kind of try to shrug it off so it's just me and the bar.
Okay.
I wrote the medical aid check.
Okay.
So that's... Or five. No successes, but I like to push my luck.
Okay. Do you have any ones?
No ones.
Okay. So let me know if you got any ones on this one as well.
Okay. Nope. Still no six. I got 1-1.
All right. So mark that you have 1 foobar now.
Okay.
You're trying to find a way to bandage it. You're using the gauze on your ankle as best as you can, but this gauze it's for treating a gunshot wound. It's not doing much to brace your ankle. Every time you roll, it just gets loose again without any way to really hold it together tightly. So that's... That is expended, so go ahead and take that off your inventory.
Okay.
That personal medical kit. So though that is gone, however, you do not take your, if you see on your character sheet where it says treated, you do not fill that bubble in yet because you were not treated, but you also do not regain the endurance point.
Okay.
As far as the healing goes, if you guys remember, that's one healing use of rallied and one use of treated between combat events.
Did he use up his treated?
He did not.
Okay.
Because it was unsuccessful.
Okay.
Conversation is getting closer, Private Burke. As you're listening into their voices, make me one more intelligence perception, please.
I can make those all night for you, sir.
Yeah.
Three successes.
Okay. You're able to hear the voices a little bit better now.
A todere. Qui scuote baci. Spat scuotere rieni. Pai solto dame se vicere.
And then the other voice.
Papa, iscotanci. Meso tre piazzi catoici.
Grazie, pardonne. Parte si è tomito, se. Parte così si mi ha tolto seminari.
Can I see, like, the disparity in height between the two people?
They're in the tall grass, but you do definitively note the difference in voice. One of these is a child's voice.
Okay. I'll look back and be like, civilians.
Lie low for now.
I'll stay still, see if they, hopefully they pass. I don't know what they're doing on a beach in the middle of an invasion, but.
You know. Well, you guys are a little bit more inland than the beach.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I'm assuming. No, I'm gonna try to stay still for now. Hopefully, okay. they go away.
As they're looking for you guys, they pass by, only about 5 feet away, moving through this tall grass. You can see that the man has a pitchfork in his hand. And that the child is carrying a teddy bear. But they move through this tall grass past all of you as you remain quiet and still. They have not seen you.
Let them pass.
Mm-hmm. Okay. As they pass, you have the moment now with just the three of you here in this space. The gunfire has gone quieter and quieter. It's mostly the sounds of the field around you now.
Do we still hear the ocean? How far inland do I think we are?
You do not hear the ocean anymore. Haven't heard it since you landed. Those strong winds have pushed you a long distance.
So I look at the other two, I go northwest. That was a question, gentlemen. Northwest?
I think Bobby froze.
Oh, sorry. Yep. Northwest is the way to go then.
There he's back.
Oh, would it be possible to pull out my compass and map and try to figure out where we are?
Absolutely, yeah. Make me a survival check.
Can I look over and help him?
Sure. Two of you are kind of trying to gauge what you can see in the night sky and figure out what's where.
Ooh! Oh, man.
That good? Or that bad?
Four successes.
Okay. as you're looking at the map here,
You invented GPS.
You, judging by the relative position of the moon and the stars, you have landed not too crazy far away from Ponte Olivo. You can tell from your position, this field is actually up a little bit on a hill. And judging by where that anti-aircraft fire was coming from, being the landing fleet, where you are, and you have heard an airplane take off since you guys have landed, a little bit off to the northwest of you, the fact that this pond is fed by a creek that is mostly straight, we'll tell you that, yeah, you guys are probably... Let's check a map here. You're probably about 2 miles away from Ponte Olivo, the airfield you have been designated to attack to.
Let's follow the creek, blow some holes in that airfield.
To be fair, the so there is the road that goes up, and then the creek runs parallel.
Well, still on the other side of the creek, away from the road.
Yeah, I'd still rather follow the creek than the road.
Okay. With that tremendous survival roll, you're able to navigate this really well through the fields here. And as you're moving along, let me, with that super high roll, Parker, let me get you to roll doubles for me.
Twenty-six.
What you come across as you're moving by is the wreckage of a downed Dakota. You can hear the fire crackling in it. It is completely ruined. It lights up the field around it, and you can see it really well as soon as you come across this little hedgerow. It's very, very visible. There was probably no way anyone survived that.
And that's probably going to be a beacon where they're going to come straight to. It's lit up like a fire right now, right? I don't know. What do you think, Webb? Should we try to go over there and see if anyone is left?
I was thinking about that, but we may want to at least scope it out first before we go over there, or at least come along the edge line. Let's do that.
We'll go by it. We'll drive by it.
Okay. As you kind of give it a bit of a wide berth going around, let me get a group perception check, please.
1 success.
4 successes.
Ooh. 2 successes.
There we go. The crew in the cockpit of it are dead. The pilot and co-pilot's heads are kind of slumped in a burnt, mangled mess. The most interesting part is the fact that it seems to have fallen on a cow, as there is half of a cow kind of sticking out from under the wing. No survivors.
Can I check for any medical equipment?
Yeah. I'll say with that perception check that you guys got, I mean, anything that was in here has burned up. Because this thing is an inferno.
Okay. Relative to the airfield, what position are we? Like on a 6th grid? Like what position?
That airfield at this point is going to be about 1.5 miles northwest.
Okay, so we're coming in from the east.
Yeah, you're approaching it from the southeast.
Okay. No, I tell the guys, you know, I recommend we head due west and try to meet up with any forces that are coming up, because that's where they're going to come from.
It's a good plan as any.
Like, 3 of us can do some damage, but I don't know if 3 of us can do that much damage.
Seems like our best plan so far. So we'll move forward with it.
There's a twig that snaps not too far away from you guys. Off to your right, probably about 15 meters out. A little bit of movement in a bush.
Do I see anything?
Make a perception check.
And what was the countersign? They never They just said use it. They didn't say what it was.
You know what? You're totally right. That's my bad. Because I looked for it and I couldn't find it. So I apologize to the history buffs watching this. If I got this wrong, we will use the classic D-Day Thunder Flash. One of you says Thunder, the other says Flash. If they don't say Flash back, that's a bad guy and you need to kill him.
Three successes.
Okay. You see exactly the bush that it came from. And the fact that there is somebody crouched down within that bush.
I'll aim that way and I'll just say thunder in a loud whisper.
After a moment, you hear the flash.
Get your ass over here. How many are with you?
You hear a little bit of shuffling from within the bush as stepping out from it is a very beleaguered looking Private Sanchez. He's lost his helmet and has just kind of got his wavy black hair on his top of his head. Nothing else protecting the grape. As he comes over to you guys.
Oh, it's you guys. Man, it's good to see friendly faces.
Get down.
I'm sorry.
You are alone by yourself out here?
Yeah.
He survived. You owe me a quarter.
Taking bets. I like it. Yeah, I lost my gun, too. I lost all my stuff. Well, I got a Sanchez. Knife, though.
Great job out there.
Look, I didn't choose when we jumped. I just jumped.
I point at the wreckage, and I'd be like, they don't need it. See what they got.
That place is an inferno, man. Nothing left in there.
Did you guys find anything else?
Cow and some civilians.
Each other.
Now, that's something. Telling you, being out here alone sucks.
No, you're not alone anymore.
All right,
what's up?
So I gotta find a squad lead. I gotta radio in as soon as we find them. We gotta regroup for what we can, or should I just go ahead and radio in now? What do you guys think?
Yeah, I'll look over at the wreckage and see if around the cockpit, if it's safe to approach it, or if it's like, don't.
The majority of the fire is kind of in the middle of the fuselage and along the wings. The cockpit portion has already burned its burnables.
Oh, yeah, okay. I mean, we could still probably get a helmet out of it.
Okay, you're going to pilfer a helmet for Private Sanchez?
Yeah, I'll be like, get over here!
Okay, I'm coming.
I'll go over there, try to find at least a helmet.
The pilots had their helmets on. As you kind of peel it off of the head of the pilot where it was kind of melted a little bit to the flesh on the top of the head, it's pretty gruesome. It's filled with hair and scalp, but it is a helmet.
I'll just look at it and hand it to him.
He immediately starts throwing up. As he just drops it on the ground and starts puking.
I'm a radio in.
Okay. It's your choice, brother.
Yeah. Okay, so go ahead and as you get the small radio out, go ahead and make me a tech check, please.
Okay.
For your radio.
One success.
Okay. With the radio in hand here.
Would I be able to help him? That's tech is my highest of all my stats.
Yeah, for sure. You got one more dice if you'd like to roll that.
Okay. Still one.
Okay. As you start trying to tune in the radio, getting it locked in, you can hear that somebody's hot miking. There's sounds of gunfire in it. But you do hear some radio chatter.
I immediately checked my mic when you said someone's hot miking. I was like, oh shit.
No. You guys are good.
I say, hello? This is Private Web, over. Do you copy?
As you say your words out and you tune in the channel, there's a moment where the background chatter is kind of minimized. The voice that comes back to you, this is Lieutenant Lee. Private Webb, that you?
Yes, sir, it is. So you're still alive and kicking.
Roger that, over.
I'll bring over the map and kind of point at the latitude and longitude so he knows what to relay.
I give him the coordinates of where we're at. Let's say we're heading along the riverbank, going more inland.
As the radio clicks back in, roger that. All right, here's basically what I want you guys to do. I want you to find who you can, move up that riverbed, over.
Sir, roger that, sir. We get right on it.
It comes back in again. Rally any troops that you can find. I want you to push in from the right flank. Okay, push from the east. Break, break. Once you find some companions that can mount that assault, break, break. I want you to grab them and lead that yourself, Private Webb, unless you find someone higher. I'll copy. Over.
Copy, sir. Over and out.
As the radio tunes out, as you conserve your battery as best you can, you got your marching orders.
I relay it to the team. Let's say, first things first. Scout the area for any survivors. And go along the east side. And flank that way.
Sanchez, you're about as useless as tits on a truck right now. How are you at stealth?
I'm pretty sneaky when I need to be.
All right. Looks like you're a new scout.
Great. Pulls the knife out.
Don't get too mad. I'll come with you. I don't mind scouting with you, buddy.
Yeah, I appreciate it.
All right. Guess we march 2x2s.
Yeah. All right. You two lead the front. We'll be in the back. Stay alert. Stay vigilant.
As you move up a little bit more, there's a very putrid smell that starts to assail all of your noses.
Am I familiar with that smell? Have I ever smelled something like that before?
I would say no, you have not.
Can I associate the smell with something burning?
It's not something burning.
Sancho, do you know what that is? You smell that, right?
Yeah, I smell that too. I don't know, man. Stinks. Kind of pulls his shirt up over his nose.
Does it feel like we're getting closer to it? I feel like we're getting closer to it. I don't want to get closer to it.
Do I see any clouds of gas or anything? Or is it just a smell?
Make a perception check.
Sorry, it's a lot of dice.
No, you're good.
3 successes and 1 on the floor. I don't know what it is. We'll just leave it. Well, here's okay. Another die. 3 successes.
Okay. You don't see any gases or anything, but what you do notice through the tall grass up ahead is where it's kind of flattened a bit. And you can see that there is an American paratrooper who is laying on the ground, his intestines eviscerated and kind of slopped out next to him. Also next to him is a German soldier who has a hole in the front of his head that has pooled the blood next to his body. And the pistol in the hand of the paratrooper will make it relatively clear that this was a confrontation. A blood-soaked bayonet in the hand of the German.
Tell Sanchez, cover your nose, go get a shooter.
I crawl up there with Sanchez.
Okay. He kind of plugs his nose as he goes up and takes the pistol out of the dead American's hand.
I'll stay with him as well.
I look for a medical pouch.
I'm watching their back.
Okay. Make me a, let's see. This will probably still be perception. I want to go survival on this. I feel like survival needs more uses. We do a lot with perception.
Who's making that roll? Sorry.
Oh, Private Web.
Okay.
No successes.
This guy lost most of his gear, it looks like. Really all he had was his ammo belt on his waist. He doesn't even have his rifle.
Shoot. Yeah, limp on back. In formation.
Okay.
Well, let's continue on forward.
Private Webb will also swipe that bayonet as he's kind of wiping the blood off of it and putting it into his pocket. What? It's for my Tia.
Tia's love stabbing things.
Whatever yeah, they floats do. Their boats.
Hey, you haven't met my Tias.
I hope I don't.
Any of them single?
You wish. Kind of checks the ammo and the pistol as he loads it. The smell that you're becoming familiar with now that will stay ingrained in your nose until the day that you die is the smell of death. What were we going to say?
No, I'll try to distract myself from the dead bodies by just pulling out my rifle, and I'll just scope up and I'll kind of just take a look around and make sure that. And even in long range, there's nobody near us.
Okay. Make me another perception check, please.
Three successes.
Okay. Looking around, you notice that there are a handful of folks that are moving kind of low through the bushes, moving north a bit further ahead of you. Looks like a group of, say, about five folks.
Might be friendlies up ahead. If we hustle, we might be able to catch up to them. And if they're not friendlies, then I guess we're going to fight them, but we need more people, right, Webb?
That's right. Sounds like we need to get boot scooting. And I already walked back. Well, while we go forward, I try to look for the dog tags for the paratrooper.
Okay. You know where they're kept, and you find it, pull it off. As you take that dog tag and kind of look at it with a little bit of... a little bit of moonlight to see. The name on it is Private Anthony Moretti.
Got it.
One of the Italian members of your squad.
Yes, at least he's resting at home.
Yeah. Rest in peace, man. Stick the dog tags back in.
Okay. The way these dog tags usually go, you have two dog tags. So there's one that's on the main chain and one that's a small chain. So you would pull that one off and that you could turn in to your command and let the message know. The secondary dog tag is so that whoever finds him will know, first of all, that someone else has reported it. And if somebody else, like, down the road finds him, they'll know who he was.
Gotcha. Okay, then I do that.
Get the body home. Okay.
Okay.
With you can add Private Moretti's dog tag to your inventory.
Okay. Well, boys, let's continue forward with those possible friendlies.
Okay. you've got the jump on them, but so let me get a an infiltrate check from everybody. You can add a dice because you do have nighttime kind of making it hard for you to see. And you can add a second dice because you've got the jump on them and know where they are. They don't know where you are.
Two successes.
Okay.
One success.
Okay.
One success.
Perfect. You sneak up on them in pretty short order. They're moving very slowly, definitely taking their time to be observant and trying to be stealthy. The fact that you know where they are and you have a movable objective, you find them pretty quickly and find yourselves to a point where you're only about 10 meters behind them. Still haven't spotted you.
I'll kind of say, like, you know, us that way, you that way.
Yeah.
It's kind of...
I'll get my bayonet ready.
Okay. Bayonet goes on the tip of the rifle. The pistol is kind of held in the shaky hands of Private Sanchez.
Now, once we're in place and we're kind of following them, I'll just whisper, "Thunder."
See a little bit of rustling as I kind of shuffle around. You hear... Who said that? Who said that?
Thunder.
Oh, shit. What was the word? It's Flash, dumbass. Flash, Flash.
You fucking idiot.
You almost fucking died.
I was about to kill you.
You got real lucky there.
They kind of quickly hurry over to you guys. It's several more of the guys from your squad. This is going to be PFC Krajewski, Private Jones, Doc Davis, one of the medics, as well as Private Corsetti.
Be like, "Corsetti, sorry about Moretti. We found him a few yards back there."
Yeah, thanks, man. Yeah. It's a shame. It's a shame.
He's a good guy.
He was like a brother to me. I'm glad we got a... For sure what happened. We couldn't find him. He got separated from us. He was swinging out wide. We were at a gun shop, but we never found where he went.
Wasn't Sicilian, but we'll pretend he was. He's home.
Italy's Italy, huh?
Yes, sir.
Kind of signs the cross. Pulls out a small Roman Catholic necklace with a little cross and kisses it. Puts that rosary back down inside his uniform.
Say, "Hey, Mr. Medic Man, you mind checking out my ankle?"
Mr. Medic Man. Doc Davis. Yeah, sure. Yeah, take a seat.
Can you get my knee after him?
Yeah, you guys got dinged up on the landing too?
Yeah, they shot out part of my chute.
Okay. Yeah, I'll take a look. Let me see.
Web radioed in. Got some orders.
With a splint pulled from his medic bag, he puts that around your ankle, and using a belt that he's actually taken, which is a German belt, he tightens it just about as tight as he can get, wrapping it around your ankle for really good support. You can go ahead and check off the treated and increase your endurance back up by one. For Private Parker. As he's taking a look at your knee and where it's impacted, he fashions a similar type of impromptu splint that he's able to tightly tie onto it. And he actually has a little bit of leather that he's scrounged, probably from a saddle by the looks of it, that he kind of puts as like a knee pad almost. You may also check off the treated and your 1 point of damage to your endurance. Also, you guys' agility that was decreased will go up with that endurance that's been healed.
There we go.
Back to ship shape.
Nice. I debrief everyone on the mission right now, heading east, and also on finding other friendlies on the way there.
I gotta make a note of that real quick, because that is one of Joseph's characters that just healed you.
Heck yeah.
His backup character is a doc. So he'll have two uses expended on that med kit. The most senior of all of them is going to be TFC Krajewski, who's you all know him. You guys are all pretty good buds. He's like a second generation American, Polish family. Kind of looks at you with a little bit of raised eyebrow. Well, I don't want to be the one to break this to you, but I am a private first class. He kind of gestures to the chevron in his arm web.
I say, well, private first class, I got orders from Lieutenant, so if you want to take it up with him, you can take this radio and do what you need to do about it.
He kind of looks at you for a second. We're going to move east.
Just be like, follow the shovel.
He kind of stops for a second. And he gets right up next to you, Webb, kind of leaning in. You said east, right?
That's right, boss man. East.
Okay. Yeah, we head east. See, kind of stops one more time, leans back into you again, Webb. Which way's east? We head east.
Yes, give the point.
All right. Keep spacing. We're going to move out. Stay low, stay quiet. Keep your weapons ready. We're going to find our brothers, rally, and get ready for the attack. Everybody clear on that? All right.
Got it.
He
sounds like a solid plan.
He begins moving out as all of the rest of you moving through. We'll continue to pick up stragglers up until the point where almost all of your squad is assembled now. From what you guys can tell, from Second Squad, there has been only a couple of casualties on this landing from everyone that you talked to, right? Moretti, you found him. You'll also find the body of Private Janvier. Looks like he was probably blown in half during the jump. Because the top of him is still attached to the parachute, but there are no legs.
Would I have collected his dog tag as well?
Yeah.
Okay.
Nobody has the dog tag for Bobby's secondary character. So
hey, now.
They will be forever listed as MIA, because there's nowhere to prove what happened to them.
We saw it. He got his head blown off.
Yeah, you guys saw. Also killed during the jump is going to be Private Alessi, as you will find him about 10 minutes later up the road. His parachute seems to have been caught in a tree where he has dangled, and it looks like he has been shot numerous times as his torso is perforated with bullet wounds. That carnage will finally come to a little bit of a more positive note when, having rallied and found these bodies, you see a finally slightly more reassuring sight for the first time in a while. And that is going to be the floppy hair kind of billowing in the night wind here of Sergeant Ellington. He's got his Thompson submachine gun in hand. Glad you guys made it.
The order, Sergeant.
Glad to see you in one piece.
Likewise. Any news to report?
Got a few casualties. I list out those names. I tell them the orders, give it to me by Lieutenant. And just what we've done so far.
All right. Sounds good. Appreciate the update. You hand me those dog tags. We'll make sure that they get turned in appropriately.
Yes, sir.
Kind of puts them into his big baggy cargo pockets. All right, boys. Here's the situation. Before we go pushing in for the airfield, there's a little house up that way. I'm going to need a couple of you. Burke, Webb, Parker, you guys look like you're in pretty good shape. I'm going to send the three of you guys to scout up at that house. Pretty sure that we saw a truck drive up to it. Haven't seen much movement. Get up there, see what you can. If you find the enemy, kill him. If they got a truck, take it. If you can't take it, destroy it.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You got it, Sarge.
Minimal civilian casualties on this. Don't go firing willy-nilly. Make sure you know who you're shooting at. I've already had more friendly fire and civilian casualties than I'd care to count. Reported to me by folks on the drop so far. And it's like 3 a.m. Everybody else, sit tight. Set up a defensive perimeter. Fan out. We'll wait here till you guys get back. Once you've secured that truck, we'll either use that for our push, or if you blow it up, we'll take that as a signal for us to go ahead and push ahead. Blow it up as a last resort. Steal it if you can.
Roger that.
You got it, Sarge.
Be careful who we shoot.
Generally, a good rule of thumb. You guys good on ammo? You got all your gear? I know a lot of guys are landing without gear, but it looks like you guys have most of it.
Rations. Gas mask.
I don't have any spare gas masks, but I do have some rations I can give you. Kind of puts his own bag down and fishes out a K ration for you.
Thanks, boss. Sanchez
needs help finding his ass.
When has that not been true? You see Sanchez just kind of like glare at you. Shut up, Burke. There's a kind of like off glance at him from Sergeant Ellington. Why do you have all that stuff? It's for my tia. I'm collecting stuff for my tias. This is not hard. All right.
He's going shopping.
I don't even know what a tia is, but you do you. You three, move out. We'll wait for your signal or your return.
On it.
Yes, sir.
Consider it done.
As they all begin getting slightly more dug in place, ready to defend that position, and the three of you move ever closer towards this house that you can see about 100 meters out. That's where we'll call it for tonight, and we will pick up the next time that second squad meets. Thank you guys so much for playing.
That was fun.
That was awesome. Love it.
And thank all of you for watching. Hope you guys enjoyed. Got a little taste of it. Stay tuned. There's going to be more. The next week's episode will follow First Squad and their endeavors as they have rallied and what they went through to get to this point. You may see some players from one squad hop in on the other squad. They've got backup characters on both. But hope you guys had fun. See you guys next time.